Thanks, Megan.
This news on Sergeant Bergdahl's time in captivity just broke hours ago, right before I sat down to speak with the men who served with Sergeant Bo Bergdahl. In a 30-man platoon on a tiny outpost in the far reaches of eastern Afghanistan. In a world exclusive, this is the first time these men have been together since they left Afghanistan. We are joined now by six members of Bo Bergdahl's platoon. Guys, thank you all so much for being here. I want to start with you, Evan Buteau, because you were the former sergeant. You were the team leader of the team that Bergdahl was on. What do you make of this latest reporting by James Rosen that he had converted to Islam, that he fraternized openly with his captors and declared himself a warrior for Islam, at least by August of 2012?
Well, initially after he left, we knew that he had deserted. We knew that he was trying to find the Taliban, or trying to find someone who could speak English so he could talk to the Taliban. I mean, that was known to us at the time when we were on the ground right after he left.
But trying to find somebody who speaks English and can connect him with the Taliban could mean, you know, he had some God complex, he wanted to go solve the war. It doesn't necessarily mean he's getting ready to go collaborate with the enemy against the United States.
Exactly. And at this point, we're still going to have to listen to his side of the story at some point. I think that's right now, America wants to hear what he has to say.
Raise your hand if you think he deserted. Wow. Raise your hand if you have some question about whether he deserted. Wow. All right, go ahead. Finish your point.
So, and once he got with the Taliban and got connected with them, at that point, what happened after that, we don't know. And we're going to have to wait for his answers. Now, what's coming out now about him converting to Islam and those things, we all heard those reports too. As I mean, we're all still in the army and everything.
When you think of him in captivity for 5 years, and you see that video of him coming home, you know, the Taliban released it. It's a propaganda piece, but nonetheless, it shows him. Mm-hmm. I mean, do you think this is what I would have done too, what I had to do to survive, even if it had involved saying I'd converted to Islam and took up arms against the United States? What do you guys think when you see that?
Maybe 5 days. I would have done everything I had to do, cursing them, trying to escape, swinging on them, trying to steal a gun, shoot them. I'm not going to be a propaganda piece so my family can see me on the internet.
This is, and you're Cody Full, you're a former specialist, and you were his roommate prior to deployment.
Yes, in Fort Richardson. Another thing I keep hearing is, you know, what were his motives for deserting? It doesn't matter what his motives were. We all took an oath, and we all had to abide by, you know, orders, you know, and you don't just leave your fellow Americans to join somebody else.
But explain that to us, because civilians who have never, as you guys did, volunteered our service in our lives potentially to protect America think, well, he was disillusioned, you know, he was scared, he walked off. Help us understand what a cardinal sin is.
Afghanistan's not an easy time. Iraq's not an easy time. Anytime you're in a combat zone, it's not an easy time. Everybody's struggling.
You don't do it because it's easy. We're not there because it's easy. We're there to do a hard job, and that's what you signed up to do.
We all signed up by ourselves. We volunteered. Mm-hmm. And a draft didn't come through, nothing like that. So for him to sign an oath, and like what Cody said, he signed an oath to go do his job.
And, But some people, and you know, then he gets over there, it's a different story. He claimed in his email home to his dad, according to Rolling Stone, right before he deserted or left or whatever, that he had claimed he saw atrocities, he was very disillusioned with the army. I mean, I'm putting it nicely what he said in that email.
Now, just to say, to add more to what they're saying, I mean, and yes, we did sign on that line, and we all saw, I mean, not atrocities in, like, you know, some illegal thing that was going on that was trying to get covered up or anything, but you see your friends die, you see, and unless you're there, you don't know what we've seen.
I can feel how strongly you feel about that. But to take it to collaboration, possible collaboration with the enemy, which is clearly something our James Rosen reported earlier this week, that they have a CIA file on, and that there are many in the intel community who still believe that's a possibility, and they're investigating. And now the latest reporting about, you know, shooting AK-47s with the Taliban, doing target practice with the Taliban, clearly a relationship had developed. It seems hard to believe that an American soldier would do that unless he had gone mad or if he was trying to save his life.
He doesn't seem like a captive. He seems like someone who is potentially
enjoying himself by
But wouldn't
by having...
you do it if they, you're Josh Cornelison, you were a medic in the platoon.
Correct.
Wouldn't you do it too if he tried to escape? They got him back. They put him in a cage for 5 days. Wouldn't you then do what you had to do to save your life?
You do everything you can to get back to your guys because you know that they care about you. You care about them. You would put your life down for them, and they're going to do the same thing for you.
So what's the best evidence you have that the night he went missing and ultimately wound up captured, he was doing it intentionally?
Okay. The morning that we found out he was missing, someone went to wake him up for his guard shift. He was not there. He was not in his tent. His weapon, his bulletproof vest, his sensitive items were left behind in the tent. We looked around the small OP we were on. It was the size of maybe 2 acres. Some wire, some areas where anyone could just walk right up. It wasn't like a structured base with walls and a gate. We had trucks fanned out. We had a couple bunkers. That was it. It only took a few minutes to look around and see that he was not there. And at that point, we knew nothing. We knew he was gone, and we had nothing else to go on. So we pushed a patrol out right away to go to the neighboring village that's right there to see if we could find somebody who could give us some information, a direction of travel, if they saw anything. And we got out about 10 feet out of where we walked out, and two boys who were walking to school came up to us and said, "Hey, there was an American crawling through the weeds that way." And they pointed us in the direction,
and that's the lead we followed because that was the only lead that we had. And
I was actually on the patrol too.
I was too.
They said he has no weapon with him. He has no gear with him. And if you know infantrymen, when we go on patrol, we're slammed with gear. I mean, there's no. So they said that it was weird. He was by himself. You guys are never by yourself.
You never go anywhere without your weapon.
And he had a conversation. Was it with you, Evan, as the leader about? Yeah. What would happen to him if he took sensitive information, if he just happened to wander off and took sensitive
Well, he said things. What would happen if my sensitive items went missing, which is a rhetorical question for any soldier to ask, because no one doesn't know the answer to that question.
You're going
to
get in a whole lot of trouble.
Everything shuts down. If a weapon goes missing, everything's going to shut down.
And how many people here had a conversation with him prior to the night he went missing about his, I might walk off and go into India someday, I might walk off into the mountains someday? Because I read it, a few of you did.
Yeah, he said that to me. It was probably a week or two prior. We were on a different mission, got stuck up on top of a mountain for about a week or so. And just, you know, sitting around waiting to do our guard shifts or whatever, talking to me, just, you know, making jokes or whatever. And he says, you know, I could just, you know, see myself getting lost in these mountains. I was like, well, I couldn't see myself, you know, here, but maybe in like Colorado or Alaska. So I wouldn't want to, you know, be stuck in the mountains in this country personally.
Did he say anything to any of you guys, though, about I'm disillusioned with the war effort? I hate the Army.
He never said to me that he hated the Army. He came to me at one point and said that he was concerned and frustrated with the Army's approach to the war and what we were doing. He said he was frustrated with that.
He was a little disappointed in the way he thought us going to war was going to be, we were going to go to war. You know, it was gun battles every day. You know, the war today is not that way. You know, as he said, Cody stated, it's all, you know, we're trying to get hearts and minds, trying to get the right way to go. Mm-hmm. And he was very... I mean, it was discouraging to him.
Yeah. So when the Rolling Stone article came out, we were all kind of like, what? Because the emails...
Because it had these devastating quotes from
the emails he sent to his father were completely different from what he was saying to people in the platoon about what he felt about the war.
He wasn't talking about the horror of being an American.
No, he was wanting to do more aggressive stuff, and he was frustrated that we weren't allowed to do it.
Do you believe... Because I know you have some anecdotal evidence that you feel, a couple of you feel, the attacks got worse on your unit after he disappeared and so on.
I think everyone would agree that that's clear.
Mm-hmm. And whether that the attacks got worse.
Oh, yes.
But how many of you believe that he had something to do with that?
Well,
raise your hand if you believe that.
It's hard to say. It's way too hard to say. There's way too many different things that can go with that, whether there's new people that came into the area, you know, new bomb makers that came in, or if he shared information. I mean, that's so speculative.